Did this poor pet 4032 get to enjoy its retirement after years of hard work for a West Coast school district? No, the poor thing was shoved into a damp storage locker for over 20 years. Today, let's give it the complete makeover it deserves. One part of computer restorations that can be immensely satisfying is the cosmetic restoration of a badly aged machine. This is the part that anyone can see at a glance. Hey, I can spend days tracking down a tricky issue with a scope and the meter, and the wife ain't gonna give two hoots, but a beat up, rusty old machine returned to beautiful condition is something anyone can appreciate. I had planned for this video to come out after the mainboard restoration, but since that's waiting for parts to come from over the pond, we're gonna have to take care of the ugly first. This poor old pet spent at least a couple decades in a damp storage container in the San Francisco area. You can see from the keyboard grime and the rust that there was no shortage of water and dust to keep it company. This machine presents an extra tough challenge because parts of the chassis are metal and have severely rusted. Much of the hardware was also corroded beyond reasonable recovery. So today, let's take a look at what's possible and bring this machine back to its former glory. So let's start with the metal base. This one was a bit of a puzzle. It was not as rusty as some of the other metal parts and has the labels and original school district engraving on it. What I've decided to go with is to gently sand and treat the rust with Fertan. Then I'll use an automotive touch-up paint pen to cover any bare spots to prevent rust in the future. Part of the reason I decided to go this route is I thought the outside looked pretty good and I really like the original markings. The transformer was restored in an earlier video that I will link below. Before we can reattach the cover to the hinge, we need to try to restore the keyboard that's been terrifying me for months. This keyboard is similar to a VIC-20 or Commodore 64 keyboard in construction. In fact, early VIC-20s were made using PET keyboards like this one waiting for restoration. It's missing the left shift key and some keys are a bit wonky and missing their springs. I guess I can't put this off anymore, so let's dig in. Don't know what I'm gonna find. While the construction is a bit different, the keys are still removed with a simple wire key puller like on most keyboards. As each of these grimy, nasty things touched my bare skin, ugh. Let's just say that each key went into a bit of warm, soapy water, and when I was done, my hands got the same treatment. Repeatedly. I set the springs aside and cleaned them with a bit of alcohol later. Several springs were missing and one was badly deformed, so I did a little test and found that the springs for a Commodore 64, although a bit shorter, seemed to work quite well. I'll have to use about a half a dozen of them, at least until I can find some proper PET springs. With the keys taking a badly needed bath, we remove the 19 screws from the circuit board on the back and remove it. Besides a plenitude of dust, it's actually looking pretty good. It got wiped down with a cloth, lightly dampened with alcohol, then each contact was carefully cleaned with a cotton bud soaked in the same. Under the circuit board lies the key plungers. These look a lot different than the Commodore 64 ones I'm used to, but they work on the same principle. The big issue is a conductive coating on the end of each. The carbon is reputed to lose electrical conductivity over time, making the keys respond poorly, if at all. There are ways to fix this, such as conductive paint, like I have here, or conductive pads sold for fixing remote controls.
I seriously considered just treating the pads while I had the keyboard apart, but I really felt it was important to give the originals a chance.
After wiping down each plunger with a damp cloth, I cleaned each pad with some alcohol on a cotton bud, then gently abraded them with a sheet of 10,000 grit sandpaper, otherwise known as copier paper.
I did test a few with my multimeter, and they all seemed to read about 150 ohms.
Looking at the service manual, they are rated to remain below 1K ohms over 10 million keystrokes, so I'm hopeful they're going to work.
Of course, I won't really be able to test this keyboard until I have the PET running, so we'll all find out if this keyboard works as it is during the next video.
After removing the frame for the keyboard, I saw that it looked like it had gotten hot and melted at some point.
So I did a little investigation and I came to the conclusion that it probably came out of the mold that way, and Commodore being Commodore, It got used because it works as it is. So all the plungers were returned to the frame and the circuit board was reinstalled. Then it was time to reinstall the many keys and springs, which I laid out in advance for easier installation. Whew! Finally, the metal frame that holds the keyboard to the main body has some rusty spots and looks generally pretty shabby. This got sanded and treated with a rust converter before I repainted it with a high zinc paint. This looks much better, and the high zinc content should maintain electrical conductivity. I'm totally thrilled how this keyboard came out. So once I get that final missing shift key, this keyboard will be complete, but I am thrilled by the way it came out. I thought it was going to be a crusty mess. This thing looks awesome. Now that the keyboard is restored, we can install it in the cover. It's held in by this metal frame and 12 screws. When I took it apart, I found that many of these screws were loose and felt stripped. The original screws were slightly tapered at the tip, so when I got replacements, I got ones that did not have the taper, which allowed them to hold securely in the existing boss without causing damage. Now we can reinstall the cover to the base's hinge. I like the way the hinge is set up. Two of the five screws have one washer and screw into a threaded hole in the hinge. That makes it really easy to get the machine aligned and attached so the other three screws, which have multiple washers and a kept nut, can be added once the system is already secured. I did find that having three hands would have still been helpful, but I used my head. Okay, maybe I used my face. I tried everything to remove the rust stains from the cover. I started with the usual suspects like Windex, alcohol, and a magic eraser. Next, I tried a couple rust treatments, Evaporust and Fertan, neither of which touched the stains. Finally, I tried some light abrasion with some fine sandpaper, but even that didn't help. In the end, I decided the cure was likely to be worse than the disease, especially since the area will be covered by the CRT chassis, so I left it as it is. What a mess! It has large areas of deep rust, so there is no way to save this finish. It got sanded with several grades of paper from about 80 to 440 grit. Yes, it was so bad that 80 grit was necessary. The painted areas also got lightly abraded with the 440 grit. Once the bulk of the rust was removed and the surface was smoothed, it got two 24-hour Fertan treatments. The Fertan converts the remaining rust to zinc oxide, which is a paintable surface. Next, the CRT chassis was primed with a couple coats of Duplo Color Scratch Filler Primer with a light sanding after each coat. Finally, the entire thing got a few coats of Duplo Color Stone White Automotive Paint. This is the best color I could find. It came out a little bit lighter than I thought it would, but once the machine was put together, it works quite well. The CRT chassis then just mounts to the cover with four kept nuts. Yes, they're called kept nuts. I didn't know that either. Man, that looks awesome. Now it's time to bring out the CRT that's been secreted away in a secure place for a couple of months where I've paranoidly been careful not to break it. It looks pretty good, so we can just carefully wipe it down with water. You can see just how much soot and gunk builds up on these as they're used, and a school district machine was probably used quite a lot. The CRT mounts in the CRT chassis with four screws with large washers. The original washers were in good shape, so I reused them with replacement screws. I know, it looks scary, doesn't it? Believe me, I was very careful not to damage it, especially the delicate neck. The CRT bezel is attached with four tapered screws through these ears on the CRT chassis. Again, I reused these screws since they were in okay shape and I could not find replacements that had the taper. The ears on the CRT chassis were a bit bent, and thinking I had bent them, I straightened them while doing the painting. They were supposed to be bent, so I had to undo my dork move. Finally, the top cover slides on and is fastened with two screws. And wow, this is looking so awesome. Once the last few parts come in, I can finally get it up and running. I can't wait. Looking at how it was before compared to now just blows my mind. I'm still undecided on whether or not to touch up the cover, so please let me know your thoughts in the comments. I will have the final electrical restoration video up just as soon as I can. I've got parts on order, and once I put them in, hopefully I won't have to order more parts, but as soon as it's ready, I'll get the video up. I hope you liked this video, hint hint, and you might like this one where I first saw this beautiful Pet 4032, or this one where I did the thing with the stuff. Thanks for coming!